to Kavis Tarabi. How are you doing?
Good evening.
Good evening. Very well, thank you.
We'll get to those records in a bit. By way of further introduction, you are two-thirds of the Utopia Strong, of course. Together, you've written a book entitled Medical Grade Music. I should point out, we are in our various locations, so apologies for any delay on the line or indeed if any of us get confused. Who wants to take on the job of summing up what this book is all about?
Oh my God, I will take over, but I think probably it's better coming from Carver's, because I seem to always have been doing that in some ways. But it may be for the fact that this is a proper interview from a proper radio show. Why not let the long-term musician Kavis Tarabi from Cardiac's Knife World and now the Utopia Strong take over?
Thanks for the intro, Steve. Very nice. Yeah, yeah. Sorry, what was the question again?
For me, this book is about your journey as musicians and music lovers, and also, in one case, six-time world champion snooker player, to the point where you meet and you make music together and the records that you love along the way. Is that a basic idea of the book in your view?
Yeah, that sounds about right. I mean, what happened with the book actually is, you know, we had been doing, Steve and I had been doing a radio show together for some time. We started at Phoenix FM and then we moved over to NTS. And we'd just been doing this show where we played kind of music that we were into. We realized since we became friends that there's a really big overlap in the kind of, you know, far out music that we liked. And then we were called in to Faber and Faber, and they had this idea of us doing a book together somehow, you know, that we hashed it out, a kind of radio, a book version of the radio show. But then as we started writing each chapter about, you know, we were going to do 52 chapters where we recommended an album by an artist or a band as a sort of way into that band. So there would be, you know, we were going to do like a Voivod one and, you know, like a kind of a Magma one and a Koenji Hayaki one and, you know, I don't know, Don Caballero, just a load of Art Zoid, a lot of bands that people maybe aren't hip to. But as we started writing it, we sort of got to the point where it felt like we were repeating ourselves. I mean, neither of us are music journalists. And, you know, I felt like I was sort of running out of superlatives. And to cut a long story short, we spoke back to the book people who had now moved to White Rabbit Books, Lee Brackstone. And he said, look, the stuff that you've written already, I really like the memoir part of it. So it sort of from there on turned into more of a memoir of sort of both growing up and getting into music in my case and moving to London, joining Cardiacs. And in Steve's case, you know, his transition from, you know, being a professional snooker player into being a DJ and then a musician and sort of what we've done together, I think.
The thing that turned the book on its head was the fact that in the process of writing, all of a sudden the Utopia Strong was born, and there was more of a story that was totally unbelievable and totally hard to get your head around if you weren't aware of it, that we joined forces together not only to DJ, and ended up our second DJing gig was at Glastonbury. You know, things don't happen like that normally. And then the next minute is our second ever gig with the Utopia Strong was also at Glastonbury. And I don't think we could have predicted how it was all going to unfold. So we felt like the book would tell the story better, and then we could champion the cause of all these great unknown artists whilst we told our own story. And it's been great fun writing it. We've had enough of a laugh on the road DJing and being in the band together, but we're writing it as fans as well. So we're music fans, not journalists. So therein lies the fact that it hasn't felt like it's been a job. And during the lockdown year last year, it was a joy to do. So, you know, recounting and remembering all of the things that had happened as DJs and music stuff.
That's where Runaway Boys comes in for you, Kavis, because, I mean, this is your Top of the Pops moment as well. And it's an important one, as any Top of the Pops moment is for any individual. That's what you wanted to do with a Gretsch guitar like Brian Setzer?
Yeah, I got one eventually, yeah. I got one in about 2012, I think, finally. Got the Gretsch guitar like Brian Setzer, yeah. I tried to explain it in the book. I'd already, you know, I was already really into pop music from the few months before. Then when these guys turned up, and I had no context of the Stray Cats, I didn't realise they were like some throwback band, which, to be fair, they weren't exactly, certainly not the first album. It's really aggressive, you know. But just the sight of these three guys dressed in black, you know, impossibly beautiful, skinny guys in black wearing leather jackets and playing this this music that just sounded like from another dimension to me. And no one really put their hand on my shoulder and said, well, you know, that, you know, you need to listen to some Carl Perkins and Gene Vincent to hear where this is coming from. I didn't know what it was. And yeah, then it was like, okay, this is what I want to be when I grow up, that guy.
And there's a slight connection, I think, between the two of you in terms of your early musical journey, in that you're very much the outsider at school. You want to go and see Iron Maiden rather than go to school. You find comfort in like-minded souls in that regard. And Steve, it seems there's a similar pattern with Steve as well. Your early years, if only you're one of the prog kids at school, putting on Gentle Giant in the common room, which, you know, I'd imagine one or two of you would have liked.
Gentle Giant were a big act at the time, but I don't remember many people really gravitating towards them over others. I was listening to more obscure stuff as a kid, even than most of my peers. And it was only because I had a like-minded friend that it's good to have a mate that you can go on that journey together with. I don't know if that had been exactly the case, if I would have sought out this music on my own, so to speak. But obviously we were led by the music press and radio shows like John Peel's show and maybe the Old Grey Whistle Test as well. But I was firmly in the right place at the right time to be a prog fan. And even though I didn't like much prog, funnily enough, I did like all of the Canterbury scene. So that was my way in to so many other genres, including Magma, because a Canterbury band called Isotope were supporting Magma at the Chalk Farm Roundhouse in the early 70s. And I went along to see Isotope. It was a band with Hugh Hopper in, and then bumped into this crazy bunch of French musicians who have become my favourite ever band. And if you've ever seen Magma live, you'll know why. If you haven't, well, look them up on YouTube. But they are an astonishing band. And then that opened the doors to a whole genre of French music that most people in the UK aren't really that aware of. They were aware of all the German stuff, but not much of the French stuff has ever made it over the 22 miles to these shores.
I was just going to say, it's interesting with the French thing, because as Steve says, we've had the real revival of people understanding about what was going on with the whole German scene. But there's this wealth of just extraordinary music that gets made and is still being made, actually, in France. But certainly there's stuff in the 70s. And I think there had been such a kind of snobbiness in the British music press. The idea that the French music was really, they had their Johnny Hallyday, you know, sort of knockoff Elvis as he was portrayed. And that was about it. And the fact that there is these incredible sort of composers and artists and players over there. And meanwhile, you get people that, you know, and this is to cast no shade on the likes of, you know, what was being championed in the 70s over here. And I don't want to say that, what was going on in France, you know, the British stuff pales into insignificance compared to it. But I think it was criminal the way this stuff was ignored, and we know that the music press isn't particularly great at picking up on very, very outre bands. But this stuff is extraordinary, you know.
That remains the case to this day as well. There's so much music and so little if it gets any attention anywhere, even with the wealth of extraordinary radio stations available across it, who may sort of pick up on some of it, but there's so much that it's delightful and baffling all at the same time. And you miss stuff. For example, from my point of view, Steve, we're going to play something from Camberwell now. Just tell us a little bit about this particular record.
The track Green Lantern from the album Ghost Trade. By the end of the 70s, I was becoming very much into no music at all. I was becoming very much 24 hours a day snooker. So I sort of dropped my roots in a way. When I picked them up again, I sought out a load of bands. And one of the bands I stumbled upon by just picking up a CD that somebody had recommended was Camberwell Now's compilation. And I waded through this and thought, this is just brilliant. And then I found out that Charles Haywood was prior to that a member of This Heat. And then I sought out This Heat. And this, what is called post-punk music, just was astonishing and totally blew me away. I'd love to say I was there first time around, but I'd be a liar. And it's just great to discover something like that now. And Charles Haywood has always been an innovator. And when you listen to this record and realise it was made in the early 80s, you're thinking, well, he was ahead of his time in many ways, I feel.
We'll be right back. That's Camberwell Now and Green Lantern, as chosen by Steve Davis, who's here on Six Music, along with Carvis Tarabi, and their book is Medical Grade Music. And there's a mention of Magma earlier. Magma get three chapters. There's also a chapter for Charles Hayward. Mention of This Heat. Have you both heard this? I'm sure you have, the This Heat Peel sessions, which were recorded and broadcast in 77, and to this day sound extraordinary, and must have been mind-blowing at the time.
Man alive, yeah, the made available sessions, yeah, I know that. And particularly the version of Makeshift Earth Swahili on that is devastating. It's just so good. Yeah, I love it.
This book is a bit like your radio program in that you tell your stories and talk about records that mean a lot to you, in turn, chapter by chapter or half chapter by half chapter. And sometimes you actually interrupt each other's flow mid-story. How did you make those bits so conversational?
Well, they were conversations. When we were still not sure exactly what the book was going to be, we had a few conversations which recorded, and that they ended up getting kept. And I must thank Ben Thompson, who structured the book, because we just basically dumped a lot of information, like a lot of words on him, and he sort of cut through it and managed to structure this book out of all these disparate threads, which involved conversations between me and Steve. And also stuff that I'd written. I think I probably ended up writing, memoir-wise, maybe twice as much as what finally ended up getting used. And Ben had to sort of find the story between these two really quite mental threads from both of them. But he just thought it would be a good idea to put some of these conversations in the book that we'd had. And we thought, well, fair enough. You know, they work quite well, I think.
It was an interesting challenge for Ben Thompson to take two storylines and merge them into one, because we're alternating chapters. Carvis is telling his backstory, his history of as a musician. There's very little about the snooker world in this book at all, other than my early days practicing might have been to a bit of Caravan and Man and things like that. But as it goes on, the chapters start to merge into me telling the story of how Carvis and I met and then started DJing and then did the band stuff. Carvis continues with some of the very important stuff that he's been involved in, obviously culminating in the Cardiacs and a lot of that story. But it was a challenge to get the book right. So we don't know if it works really, but the conversational bits hopefully merge it together. But it's effectively two autobiographies in one. So, but hopefully for that reason, it doesn't get boring.
Oh, it doesn't. And it does work. And at times it's very moving and touching as well. You've mentioned Cardiacs, and Tim Smith is obviously a very important figure musically, but also personally to you as well, Carvis.
Yeah, that's right. And he died while I was writing the book. And what was kind of, and I think the right decision actually on Ben's part is, in some ways, I started writing, I wanted to just write all about the relationship that I had with Tim and what it was like being with him. And I submitted lots of this stuff, and as Ben pointed out, look, this is really lovely stuff, but this book is about you and Steve, not you and Tim. And it's like, yeah, of course, yeah, I know, I get it now. So, yes, you know, it was an incredible, you know, an incredible time of my life. And Tim, you know, Tim now, I think people are just really beginning to sort of realise what an extraordinary musical, you know, an extraordinary composer he is or was.
We're not going to play a Cardiacs number now, but we are going to play something from Nico. This is Frozen Warnings.
Into numb fire from your eyes into mine. Frozen warnings close to mine, close to the frozen borderline.
That's Nico and Frozen Warnings, and two-thirds of the Utopia Strong, Steve and Carvis, are my guests here on Six Music. That's one of your choices, Carvis, and some people, and I will say this about some of the, a lot of records, but some people are a little bit tentative when it comes to approaching Nico and some of the harmonium stuff, but there's lots to enjoy there, and that's particularly beautiful. What's the instrument playing there?
I think that's, on that one's viola and harmonium. I mean, John Cale does a lot of the instrumentation on that. And it, but yeah, this album for me, I picked this track particularly because I was a kind of a relative latecomer to Nico. I knew, in fact, her contributions on the Velvets album, the Andy Warhol album, they're my favourite my favourite things on that album. But for whatever reason, and it's so easy to do this, I just had this idea of what I thought Nico was going to be like. And in fact, it was my cousin, cousin Arash, a few years ago, who gave me the Marble Index. And he said, well, this is not really for me. It's more up your street, I think. And I put it on, and it really was, and I'd heard of the album before, but I'd never really listened to it at all. And when I heard the Marble Index, it was just, again, one of those epiphanies when it was like, my God, this album has been hidden in plain sight. I had no idea she made music that sounded like this. And it's so nice at that point in my life. I was probably in my early 40s when I heard it. And to still have a record that just absolutely knocks your block off. And the whole way it was constructed and the way it was put together. And I sort of had that, oh, right. Oh, you can make music. You can make it like this. It just has such a funny vibe. And shortly afterwards, I bought a harmonium, you know, and then that really led on. That became a really big influence on making my solo album from last year, which came out last year. Was just you know, bringing a harmonium into the equation, because you know, her and Ivor Cutler, actually, I'd always loved the sound of the thing, but I the way she used it in such a kind of otherworldly psychedelic way, it was a complete kind of epiphany to me.
Yeah, if anybody had told me when I was playing snooker back in the 80s that I'd be at some stage in my life lugging a harmonium stand across the fields at Glastonbury for my mate, so we could actually have a harmonium as part of our band, I would obviously have laughed them off. But yeah, the thought that, you know, even when I was listening to sort of strange music back in the 70s. I didn't think I'd ever like any music with a harmonium in it or an accordion in it. And there's so many great artists that have those in there. You know, you need your ears opening with good shows like Your Good Self and that. And you need help, because if you just get given the fodder that is unusual radio, you're never going to discover these things. So I've been very fortunate not only to have a lifelong friend that I bumped into at school who was very open-minded, but also bumping into the likes of Carver and like-minded people to open my ears to all of this music that I probably would have gravitated away from.
And not only that, your instrument of choice, well, tell us about it, Steve. Your instrument of choice is what?
A modular synthesizer. And for those of people that don't know what a modular synthesizer is, they will have seen one before, but it's basically a box of individual modules all screwed into a case that are all powered from behind the case. But to connect the modules together, you use wires on the front of the case, a bit like an old telephone exchange. And when I first saw one, and I wasn't new to what, I saw Mike Bourne from Teeth of the Sea playing a modular synthesizer, and I was blown away, thinking, this looks like something I could do. You know, it didn't look like there was any level of dexterity and skill of training needed, no practice. So very much knowledge based, and you sort of peel away the levels like an onion. But I thought I could have a try at this. So I bought one, stared at it for a long time because I didn't really know what was going on. And it's a little bit of a steep learning curve, but once you get over that, you can make sounds and make music and go in whichever direction you want to. And because obviously, you know, I'd mentioned this to Carvis, he said, oh, we can jam together. And by that time we'd met Mike York anyway, who'd been in Guapo, and we'd hung out with Mike and realized that the three of us got on so well. So we all had a jam. And the next minute was, we listened back to the jam and realized that, or improvised music rather, and realized that it was good. And we could make a record. So in spite of the fact that there was no plan, in the space of one day, we became a band, and we then sought out Rocket Recordings, and they agreed that they liked it, and the next minute we had a record out, in spite of the fact there was never a plan, and there was never a plan to gig either, because the Rocket wanted us to not only, you know, promote the record with loads of advertising, you know, radio things and magazines, but they wanted us to go on the road doing touring. And the next minute, without even knowing what was happening, I was saying yes to touring and being a musician. So, I mean, I've got my own entry in Discogs now. It's frightening.
And it's brilliant as well. I want to talk some more about Utopia Strong after another musical choice from you. Another one from you, Steve. This is Aksak Mabul. This is Unkaid.
Tu dis quoi?
Aksak Babul and Unkaid. Tell us a bit about that, Steve. Steve Davis, one of his choices here on Six Music.
Yeah, in trying to sort of pick a couple of tracks that weren't going to offend too many people, like a sort of 40-minute magma track or anything like that, or I sort of sought out something that's brand new, really. And when I got back into listening to the styles of music that I had done sort of in the 90s, when I was a kid, I discovered Aksak Babul, and they'd made a couple of albums, and they were linked to what is known as the rock in opposition genre, which includes bands like Henry Cow and Etron Fuleleban and Samla Mama's Manor, and Aksak Babul were part of this scene, and also guys like Albert Mercure as well. And out of the blue, last year, it seems like last year, maybe 2019, after not making a record for like 20 odd years, all of a sudden they made another album called Figures. It's a brand new album, and it is just as if they've never been away. And it's a fantastic new take on the rock in opposition genre, for want of a better word, even though it's its own thing. The whole album's brilliant, but I like Unkaid. It's a great happy track.
Yeah, fantastic stuff. And we've mentioned the way the Utopia Strong got going, and the method by which you make music as well, which sounds great and fraught at the same time, if I can put it like that, because I mean, it's based around improvisation, which can go either way. I've watched a bit of free jazz in my time at the ICA as a 10-year-old. Some of it was okay, but you know, I wonder sometimes how it's going. But there's an element of structure with it as well, isn't there? There has to be.
Well, yeah, I think so. I think we're all, because of the way we, because of the kind of what our listening tastes, I think we're all aware, definitely when we're playing live, we're aware of trying to, you know, without sort of discussing it too much, we're aware of each bit being like movement. And I think we're all sort of keen to move things on one piece. Say we play for, I don't know, we do a 20-minute piece. We want that 20-minute piece to have a bit of movement and kind of, oh, here's the structure, here's the bit where it drops down, here's the, you know, nothing sort of like planned as that. But it's you know, we definitely feel that it should get from A to B while stopping at some different places as well. Although none of that is planned, it just seems to happen. And on better nights, it sounds completely deliberate.
The reason why, even though improvising is obviously a journey into the total unknown, and for me, it's my only experience of doing it. I've never done any type of rehearsed music. I wouldn't know how to do that. But the reason why I don't think any gigs that we ever do will be as weird as a free jazz, free blowing melee is the fact that one of the instruments involved in our band is a modular synthesizer. Well, Mike's got one as well. And they lend themselves very much to repetition. So we are based in as much as the repetition of the likes of, and I'm not trying to liken us to, but the type of repetition of Steve Reich and maybe Terry Riley, there's always going to be a bit of that going on. So that's something within the band supply. So we've got this basis of something that's continually going on that is mesmerizing, hopefully, and becomes psychedelic in as much as it goes around in circles of different time periods. And then Mike and Carvis sort of, you know, work around that as well. So that's our only real structure, but there seriously is no planning. So I take my hat off to Mike York and Carvis Tarabi as the musicians they are for actually agreeing to go on stage with a snooker player and not only go on, but have no idea what's going to happen, because it could have all gone wrong.
So far, so good, and please keep them coming. You mentioned some influencing factors. You didn't mention, is it you, Steve, who comes out with the quote, Fred Frith is my Elvis? Is that you?
Oh, no, Fred Frith is my Elvis. Yeah.
Oh, beg your pardon. Sorry, Carvis. So, do you want to expand on that? Do you need to expand on that? I don't know.
I think Fred Frith, I mean, for me, Fred Frith, he has done, you know, he's sort of done everything. He's operated in a number of different outfits and bands, done loads of different solo stuff, whether it's scoring for an orchestra, improvised stuff, small band things, rehearsal intensive stuff. And you know, is just this kind of all rounder, and whatever he's on, whatever he appears on, you can tell it's Fred Frith. You know, he's got this kind of completely recognisable sound and approach. And I like this. I think I like this idea as well, that because some people get so stuck in this idea that, you know, you should only be in one band and one band till you die, and just do this thing. Whereas I've always liked this Fred Frith approach of, you know, make two or three albums with one thing and then, you know, really great, then move to something else, then come back to that thing again, then do something different. Just, you know, put yourself into different situations and see how you work best. And I like to be in situations where, you know, sometimes I'm completely in charge. Other times I'm just a foot soldier and I'm just being told, well, just play this, and just bringing what I can as a player to that. And in the Utopia Strong, again, it's a different dynamic because it's this complete sort of three-way democracy where everything is improvised. And Fred Frith seems to have been like the model for doing that kind of thing.
I think at the beginning of this conversation, I was going to ask you to retell some of the stories you tell so well in the book, but I'm not going to do that because I'll give you headline stories, and they include Barry Hearn at the Magma gig front row, also, which is such a fantastic story. But just in brief there, Steve, this is when you put on the shows yourself in a London theatre, and you know, mentor and great friend that he is, he insisted on coming along to show his support, and also insisted on having the best seats in the house.
Yeah, he got the full force of Christian Vander. You know, for the fact that Tom Paxton is his biggest, you know, he's a big fan of Tom Paxton, and it was just a leap of faith that wanted to support me in my first ever promotion to bringing Magma over. I just don't think he was aware of Magma. So yeah, he was basically shell shocked by what he'd seen, and from then on, he's obviously, but you know, he obviously thinks that I've got a complete screw loose for liking this weird music, that every other part of me is normal apart from this weird thing, as if it's some sort of like a virus of some sort. But the end result was he came along, and he came along with Frank Warren to watch Magma. So, and they played Zess as their opening track. And they brought their wives as well, which is not the four of them. You know, but apparently Barry has told me since that apparently Frank Warren quite enjoyed it for a while. So, but Barry, for Barry, it was just a leap into far too far into the future. But hopefully I've told the story well. It's actually quite a funny story as well. So I haven't given the whole story away.
Can we just talk about, you've touched on it already, future? Have you done any remote recording in the last year? Have you done anything in terms of making more Utopia Strong material for our delectation, for our delight?
Yeah, we got together in the summer. Well, we'd started on the second album before lockdown last year, and then we got together again in the summer when we were allowed to do stuff. And we've been working on, you know, we've got the structure and the basis for most of the next album. And as soon as things, you know, become easier, we're going to be sort of finishing it.
It's obviously put the spanner in the works for loads of bands, and it's much more fun doing it together than doing it remotely. And whilst obviously you want to sort of get things out yesterday, maybe it's better that you just wait until that's happened. But obviously in the meantime, we have to say thank you very much for playing some of the tracks, because it's just marvellous to hear it on the radio. We put out the Alphabet of the Magi series. We've had three private pressings on vinyl, and they've been from gigs and from rehearsals, so they haven't really needed anywhere near as much studio work to do. So they're sort of like, yeah, the sort of live arm. So we had three albums out of limited edition vinyl, and they've been long form pieces that haven't really needed too much doing to them, because they couldn't, because there were only two tracks anyway, two track recordings. And it was just great to put those out as part of our sort of live series or rehearsal series. And yeah, I think we're going to do a few more of those. They're a little bit easier to do, and have been a little bit easier to do during the lockdown period, although, because Carvis likes to lino cut and print the sleeves on the ink, that's been quite a laborious task. I didn't think that would ever be doing that. I mean, 250 vinyl album covers drying in my house.
Because they're future collectibles, Steve. Come on, you know how it goes.
I feel a little bit guilty as far as the snooker table that we pressed up all the albums on and printed them up. It was my father's snooker room, and the table was just not being used at all. So there was a cover on top of it, and we were using that to do all of the work. And but it's gone now, so now there's just an empty space. So we're going to have to sit on the floor for the fourth album of the series, and we're going to be like carpet fitters on the floor.
Okay, Carvis, it's time for your second and indeed your final choice. Why this particular XTC number?
Yeah, this was the song that spearheaded me really, really getting sort of back into XTC. In as much as I remember, obviously, things like Senses Working Overtime and Sergeant Rock when I was a kid and really loving it. But I'd never really sort of gone down the route of exploring XTC. And then sometime in the late 80s or early 90s, I'd come up to see Cardiacs in London with some friends, and the following morning they put on this track, Travels in Nihil, on, and I just could not believe this piece of music. And I ran into a room saying, my God, what is this? This is XTC. And my mind was trying to sort of connect my memory of what I thought XTC were like with this incredible sort of psychedelic, proto-sonic youth, kind of XTC's version of Tomorrow Never Knows almost. This remarkable track. And from there on, I kind of got massively into XTC. They became my Beatles, really. If Fred Frith is my Elvis, then XTC are my Beatles. But I still play this song to people who don't know XTC, and they it's not at all what people might think the band is like. But I think it's incredible.
Well, we'll be hearing more from the Utopia Strong later tonight, musically, that is, and plenty of other records too. But thanks so much for joining us, gents.
Pleasure, Gideon. Thank you. Thanks for supporting us, and keep up the good work.
Thank you. Bye.
So
sits and laughs in purple gauze. Her wings not yet unfurled. And timing off her scimitars, she waits to hear of curls. Yet no one man has set the pace, no one has tied her shoe. She don't belong to anyone, yet she belongs to you. She fills her head with idle talk. Of what is yet to come, and still believes she cannot last without the old or the past. Trying, crying late at night, this is still her cue. She don't belong to anyone, yet she belongs to you. Cannot wait for lasting love. Oh, what she thought it was to leave her now would be a sin, like lonely's haunting grin. Yourself a self-made man, think what you must do. She don't belong to anyone, yet she belongs to you. We'll be right back.
That's how I left her. She was a young thing, I was a man, I was a man. But how was I to know? In my mind she'd grow into a woman. Now I'm crying for the girl in blue satin, raindrops on satin. That's all I gave her. She was a sweet thing, I was a man, I was a man.
Turn to hate. Yes, there's nothing stop to tag along, only to be near you. You sing your silent song. I know that things were different when I passed across the same, but I never really knew, only by your other name. You go on and I will see you from two eyes that could see. You know I lost the magic that there was for you and me. And before I could regain it, you were nowhere to be seen. And all it seems you left me was a lonely, haunting dream.
Yeah. that's what you need.
I've searched for reasons why.
in the shadows, that's all you are. All face it doesn't really matter, falling too hard.
Somebody else.